Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck. I sing in the mire depths where there is no foothold. I have come into the deep waters, the floods engulf me. I greet you, brothers and sisters in Christ, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. My name is Primrose Ndoro. It's my pleasure to welcome you to this service and trust that God will bless us and will glorify His name through this service. Shall we start with a word of prayer? Sovereign Lord, we come before your throne of grace, giving you all honor and glory, for you alone are God. Because of your great love for us, we are not consumed. For your compassions never fail, they are new every morning. Greatness is yours, and all glory belongs to you. We thank you, Father, for your grace that sustains us, and we ask for forgiveness for all the sins that we have committed according to your mercies. And we pray, Lord, that you guide each family in your ways and you lead us in your paths, so that by the way we live, you are given the glory that you are worthy. We bring our church leadership before you as they shepherd your flock, guide them, Lord, especially in this unusual period we are in. We also pray, Lord, that you heal our country physically from this pandemic, and also economically and spiritually. We pray for the sick amongst us as we bring them to you, the great physician, that you touch them with your healing hand and care for them. And now we commit this service unto your leading. May you take charge, so that all who listen or watch this service will be strengthened in their faith, that they will be blessed. And all for your glory and for your honor. This we pray in the mighty name of our Lord and of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our theme today is Big Harvest, More Workers Needed. Our readings are coming from Jeremiah chapter 20, verses 7 to 13, Romans chapter 6, verses 1b to 11, Matthew chapter 9, from verse 35 to chapter 10, from verse 8. I will go through the readings, starting with Jeremiah chapter 20, verses 7 to 13. There's a subject in Jeremiah's complaint. You deceived me, Lord, and I was deceived. You overpowered me and prevailed. I am ridiculed all day long. Everyone mocks me. Whenever I speak, I cry out, proclaiming violence and destruction. So the word of the Lord has brought me insult and reproach all day long. But if I say I will not mention his word or speak any more in his name, his word is in my heart like a fire shut up in my bones. I am weary of holding it in. Indeed, I cannot. I hear many whispering, terror on every side. Denounce him, let's denounce him. All of my friends are waiting for me to slip, saying perhaps you will be deceived. Then we will prevail over him and take our revenge on him. But the Lord is with me like a mighty warrior, so my persecutors will tremble and not prevail. They will fail and be thoroughly disgraced. Their dishonor will never be forgotten. Lord Almighty, you who examine the righteous and probe their heart and mind, let me see your vengeance on them, for to you I have committed my cause. Sing to the Lord, give praise to the Lord. He rescues the life of the needy from the hands of the wicked. Here is our first reading. Our second reading from Romans chapter 6, from verses 1b to 11. There's a heading, dead to sin, alive in Christ. Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead, through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. Now if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastered over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Amen. Our last reading comes from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 9, reading from verse 35 to chapter 10, verse 8. There's a subheading, Jesus urges the disciples to pray for workers. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." There's a subheading on chapter 10 which says Jesus sends out the 12 disciples. Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely we have received, freely give. Here ends our readings for today. Before we go into the sermon, I'll kindly ask that you join me in singing hymn number 280 in our English hymn book, which says, "Breathe on me, breath of God, fill me with life anew, that I may love what thou dost love, and do what thou wouldst do."
Fill me with life anew, that I may love what thou dost love, and do what thou wouldst do. Breathe on me, till
I surrender to your working, Lord. May you carry me along by your Spirit to proclaim your word as you direct me to, so that in the end, all glory is given to you. Amen. If you are a believer, when was the last time you spoke to an unbeliever about Christ? What is easier for you to share? The latest news about COVID-19 or the good news about Christ? Your answer and mine to those questions could be the reason that we are talking today about the big harvest and the need for more workers. Harvesting is gathering in of crops when they are ripe. We don't gather them when they are not ripe. The big harvest, in reference to our theme today, is that of the multitudes in the world who are ripe or ready to give their lives to Christ if someone would show them how. That's why we call for more workers, to lead them to Christ. The word today exhorts us to take our place in God's harvest fields and get to work. It's not our place to pick those who are ripe. That she's still not quite there, or you will never be right. That is not our place. The scriptures will help us on how we are to go about it, the obstacles that we might face, and how we will stand and achieve our goal. Matthew's gospel is referred to as the gospel of the king, as it emphasizes the kingship of Jesus. In the section that we read, he is bringing out the power of the king. Here Jesus is doing what he had always been doing, teaching in the synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness, authenticating that he was indeed the Messiah he had been prophesied about. And as he did this, he noted a problem. He saw crowds that were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. That's what the Savior saw. But I doubt that the people would have described themselves as such. He also noted that though the people ripe for harvest were many, the workers were few. And what was the solution? To ask the Lord of the harvest to send out workers. So he told his disciples to pray to God to send out workers. Then he went on to tell the very people that he had asked to pray to pioneer the work. As we pray for something, chances are God will use us to do what we are praying for. So the disciples went out to the harvest fields of their time. What do these harvest fields look like today? I dare say still harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Without a shepherd, sheep wander aimlessly. They get lost, generally pay little attention to the dangers that are around them. The world is still as lost as it was when Jesus was there. Maybe more so. Sin is the order of the day, without any shame or restraint, with very little, if any, regard for God. Greediness, oppression, injustice, corruption, immorality, you name it. Christians often mocked. People are looking out for themselves, thinking they do not need God. And then COVID-19 comes along and illustrates clearly that apart from God, we can do nothing. No one really has the power or the authority that they thought they had. So this would be as ready as people can get to want to listen to the good news of Christ. But we know people can still be very stubborn. But like the disciples, we are commanded, you and I also need to pray to the Lord so that he send out workers into his harvest field. It is important that these workers are sent by him, because it is his harvest and he is his Lord. Self-appointees will quit when the going gets tough. They will abandon the flock when the wolves come. We heard what was happening to Jeremiah as he proclaimed God's truth. He was put in stocks, was mocked at, and at this point he was discouraged and having mood swings. He even considered withholding God's word, but he couldn't because he had been sent by him who has all the power. He couldn't hold it in, and he then decided to live above his mood swings. He did the will of God regardless of his feelings. He remained committed to God's cause, acknowledging that God was with him like a mighty warrior. Every believer is mandated to work in God's harvest fields because of the great commission that we were given to go in, therefore, and make disciples for all nations. It is not just for those in the evangelism committees, but for all believers. So as believers, we are all given the authority to go and work empowered by the Spirit of God. It will not be easy as we face the harassed and helpless. We think that we are out of our minds, or we are the ones to be pitied, pursuing what they see as a joy killer. We could be mocked, made fun of, persecuted, or ostracized. But we ought to remember, as Jeremiah finally realized, that the God of the universe, who always has the final word, is with us. And it is his harvest. When he gets to them, they will not be able to figure out what happened. Just before Jesus pointed out the work that needed to be done and the need for more workers, he had demonstrated his power by healing a demon-possessed man and he was accused of driving out demons by the prince of demons. And his response was continuing to do the good that he had been doing. So the answer to those who may hate us, mock us, or ridicule us for taking our place working in God's harvest fields is proceeding doing good by the power and with the authority of the Lord of the harvest. Jesus took a group of men from very different backgrounds, temperaments, social status, and used them to change the world forever. He united this diverse group of ordinary people into one family: the impulsive Peter, doubting Thomas, Matthew, the tax collector, and others. And he brought them together, and he used them to make an amazing impact on the world. He's still the same Lord. He can use us, different as we are, to make an impact on our world. But like the disciples, we also need to trust and to obey him if we are to be effective. This is what Paul is talking about in Romans, that believers should live in newness of life in Christ. Not as we were before we were saved, but dead to sin and alive in Christ, with a totally new relationship to sin. And so we can't deliberately sin because of our identification with Christ, who not only paid the penalty for our sin, but he broke the power of sin. It should no longer control our lives. Sin wants to be our master. Each day is knocking on the door, finding its foothold on our old nature. But in Christ, we died to sin. The old nature has been rendered powerless, and we are freed from sin and not free to sin. There should be a difference in who I was before the Lord found me and made me his, and after being born again, and when I trusted and believed in Jesus Christ to be my Lord and my Savior. This doesn't mean that as believers we will no longer sin. We do. But we do not want to continue in sin. We don't celebrate when we have committed sin. But we feel terrible, and we repent and go back to God and ask for forgiveness. God has begun his work in us through the Holy Spirit to draw us more and more to himself, moving us away from sin, going towards holiness and purity, as he progressively transforms us to become more and more like Jesus Christ. And as we carry out our mandate in God's harvest fields. We go empowered by the Holy Spirit, doing what those without the Spirit cannot do. Not only forgiving, but loving those who have hurt us. For God demonstrated this to us. Not only that, He also gave us the power to do it. All we need is to call on that power. And then we see what no eye has seen. We will not even comprehend what will be happening as we let God enable us to forgive and extend love to that sister, brother, parent, mother-in-law, sister-in-law, aunt, or whoever it is we are not on speaking terms with. Letting them experience the love of God through us. If they don't believe, then they will be drawn to this mighty one who told Sarah as she loved. Is anything too hard for the Lord? He can help us to do what seems impossible. We can be sure that this work in God's harvest fields will be done. But the question is, are you and I willing to be among those that God will use to do this work? The challenge currently is that we are not living by the power that He has graciously availed to us. And no difference is seen between those who are supposed to be working and those who are in the harvest field. So who will harvest who? I had a very awkward experience many years ago when I just started working. I'm a pharmacist by profession. I developed a very bad case of acne. It was uncomfortable serving anyone like that. But the discomfort took a peak when someone with acne came in and looking for something that would help them. On one hand, I would be thinking of all the ailments I wish you had anything else but that. Well, they were probably also thinking, I don't think she can help. From the way things looked, how could I be of any help to them, since we were clearly in the same predicament? If the gospel we are preaching has not made a difference in our lives, why would the other person be interested in it? Who will believe our message of who God is and what He has made us out to be? That we have fallen short of God's righteousness and corrupted His image within us. That we all need a Savior who can save us from sin and from ourselves. As Jesus taught and preached the good news of the kingdom, He proved His power and authority by healing every disease and sickness, giving evidence of who He was. The healing was physical, but it also illustrates a far more important healing that He has to do with sin. What we need most is forgiveness of our sins and reconciliation with God, which is what Christ accomplishes. This is the good news that we are to spread. But if there's no evidence for the power of God in our lives, then we'll have a hard time, like I did with my acne, convincing anyone else of this really the greatest good news of all time, which the world desperately needs to hear about and to take heed of. And those of us who have received this grace with our hearts filled with the love of God should see the harassed and the hopeless crowds with compassion. We should drive us to take action, first by living out who God has called us out to be, dead to sin and alive in Christ, truly demonstrating the power of God in us, so that those who see the evidence want to know this awesome one who has made a visible change in us. Then we can tell them the old story of the Christ who died for us, is what he says. We are often quick to deny God's power. Let's be practical, or let's be real. But we are only human, so we indulge sin and deny God's power. Yes, we are human, but something has happened to us. We are a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. And we also believe in a God who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or even imagine. So dear friends, the harvest is too big and more workers are needed. Judas Iscariot's name was there on the list of the disciples who pioneered this work in God's harvest field. But he was discredited for betraying Christ, who betrayed him. That's how he's described. It would be said to be counted with those the Lord has enlisted to work in his harvest fields, and then be discredited because of betraying Christ, holding on to that body of sin, deliberately continuing to sin, and putting off those who are ripe to receive the good news of Christ. We should rather live in light of what Paul says in Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. And the Sovereign Lord has given us a different setup with these lockdowns that we are having. Many of us are going to work, we're going to our businesses, we go to the supermarket, fuel stations, but we are not gathering at church. We can't come to church once a week and act proper and pious and feel good about ourselves. It's essential that we fellowship with other believers, surely. But for this season, there where we are, with our families, at the supermarket, at our daily workplaces, we are to live out what we believe and witness to those in our spheres of influence. Interesting that most of the times we interact with others out there, we have got a mask on, like a guard, keeping guard of the doors to our lips, as if we have been trained to control what comes out of our mouth. Harder, isn't it, to shout out in anger when someone cuts us on the road and ruffles us in the supermarket or wherever it is, when your mouth is gagged with a mask. God is training us to say what builds others up and not what destroys them, so that they are drawn closer to him. The king needs ambassadors. So each one in their lane, encouraging the discouraged, giving to the needy, comforting the bereaving, preaching and caring for the sick, and so on. We must make ourselves available to serve the Lord. Jesus accomplished the work of salvation, which only he could, but witnessing is done by his people. We have believed in him and have been saved. Now there's no longer any restriction. They preached in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria. Now we are at the ends of the world, open to all people. So let's give freely to others what we have freely received. For the harvest is still huge, and we are the needed workers. So let's share the love of God that we have received, and let him demonstrate his miraculous power through us, so that others may know that Jesus lives. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
God forgave my sin in Jesus' name. I've been born again in Jesus' name. And in Jesus' name I come to you.
penetrating indeed deep in bone and marrow, judging the attitudes of our thoughts. We pray, Father, that you use each one of us to share your word effectively, that you enable us, Lord, to be sensitive to your leading through your Spirit, so that even in the way that we live, we preach your word to others and we draw them to you, so that indeed work is done as you direct in your harvest fields. We pray that you continue to watch over each one of us, to direct us, and to strengthen us in our faith, so that in everything that we do, all glory and honor is given to you, Lord, for you are most worthy to be praised. We thank you, Lord, for this time. Thank you for your grace that is indeed always sufficient for us. And we pray that you continue to give us peace in everything that we do. We pray for all this in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Shall we receive grace? And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.